Om Tat Sat. My humble prostrations to the all-pervading Brahman, to my worshipful Guru, Swami Jyotirmanandji Maharaj, to all the sages and saints of this world, and to you divine souls watching this satsang. As I discussed yesterday, today we are starting with the Raja Yoga Sutras of Patanjali. Let us all close our eyes, pray to Goddess Saraswati to brighten our intellect, to give us the humility, the love, the compassion, the strength to understand each of this sutra, and let us live in bliss. Let each day be a beautiful satsanga. So with that prayer, we will start the Samadhi Pad. Samadhi is the super conscious state. So yesterday we had talked about the four separate sections, and each section has several sutras or formulas, mystical formulas, and each one of them is divine. So let us all dig into that and learn from it. Samadhi is the ultimate state. So in this case, Sage Patanjali has started with the people who are already on a very advanced stage, or people who want to achieve the ultimate. And that's the reason is he doesn't want to waste the time of these serious aspirants to go into the sadhana path, which is the second path, and that is for people who are still trying to learn and want to move forward. But yet the Samadhi path is also very helpful for the initial beginners, because then they can see what the ultimate potential of their effort would be, what they're trying to get to. So sadhana path is your actual effort, where you have heard about the Ashtanga Yoga that is very popular, and we'll get into that, but that will be covered more in the Samadhi path section. And then the Vibhuti path is all the glories and all the miracles and all the fragrance and beauty you will start to experience once you start walking on this path. And it will be as if your inner heart has opened up amazing gardens and vistas for you to revel in and enjoy. And that is that third section. And the fourth one is called Kaivalya Path. Kaivalya means you have achieved, or there you're beyond time and space. You're no longer in the world's stratum when you are meditating, and you have achieved the ultimate. Ultimate is Kaivalya, and very few individuals get to that state, but the serious ones are able to, who are fully determined and who are having a lot of faith and discipline. So therefore, let's close our eyes, thank God for this wonderful satsang opportunity that each of us have, and get started with this beautiful Yoga Sutras of Patanjali by Pujaniya Swami Jyotirmanandji. And I'll be narrating with the little experience that I have, that this nectar that I have been able to enjoy, I want to share with each of you. So the first sutra says, Atha Yoganushasanam. I'll repeat, Atha Yoganusashanam. Atha means now. Yoga, of course, is yoga, which means to connect. Yuj. It comes from the Sanskrit letter to connect. Connect to who? Connect to God. So our consciousness to connect to the universal divine energy. That's yoga. And anusashanam is discipline and also exposition to understand it deeper. And we use the word atha. Atha is to indicate auspiciousness in Sanatana Dharma. So every chapter starts with atha prathamadhyaya, atha dvitiyo. So we are starting, and in the end it just ends with a different form. So this is how the whole process of starting and ending works in the Sanatana Dharma. And in Anushasana, there are four things to think about in the exposition of Raja Yoga. So we will discuss about the characteristics of yoga, what it is, different disciplines within yoga, what kind of things we need to do, and then means of attainment of the yoga. How do we get there? So it's a very systematized step-by-step study of the yoga. And the fourth is called the fruits of yoga, liberation or self-realization. Why are we doing all these efforts after all? And that's what that says. So there's a saying in Sanskrit that says, mana eva naam manushyanam karanam bandho mokshayoha. Mana eva. So mind is the cause of your bondage, and mind is the cause of your release. Think about that for a minute. The mind is the one that people get so depressed that sometimes they commit suicide because the mind has convinced them it's no longer worth living. And the same mind also can take them to glorious heights of getting liberated or doing big glorious things. Same mind. So it can either free you from the cycle of birth and death, or it can forever tie you into the chains of reincarnation and embodiment after embodiment. So Raj Yoga, therefore, is of universal importance because it deals with the secrets of mind and its controls. Mind you, it says the secrets of mind and its control. Most people don't know these secrets. That's why they struggle so much in their daily life. They're frustrated, and then they figure why they don't have peace. It has nothing to do with material success or money. There are plenty of people with lots of money, more money than they know what to do with, and yet they have stress, they have tension, they are not happy. So let us totally abandon that idea that money will solve all problems. Yes, it helps you to some extent, but beyond that, it's your own self-effort, and happiness comes from within. That's the essence that we are trying to draw from this shloka. So, once you have understood the ways of controlling the mind and drawing the energy from the cosmic source, you become like a channel. You're able to draw that energy right into yourself. There is nothing impossible for one to acquire if you do this properly. See, that's this first shloka that we have started off with so much love and auspiciousness. Since Raj Yoga describes the universal vows, it says vows are such as ahimsa. Ahimsa means non-violence, which means it's a holistic approach. It wants to connect you to everything. Like, we don't like violence done to us, so therefore we should not do violence to others. That is ahimsa. Satya. Satya means truthfulness. So once you speak the truth, truth comes to you. You start becoming more radiant. And then brahmacharya. Brahmacharya is sex abstinence, but that's a smaller definition. The real definition means to abide in God, to abide in Brahman. That's why we say our prostrations to the all-pervading Brahman, because Brahman is in every single atom. If you stick with this program religiously and try to watch it every day, believe me, you will start to build that nectar of divine love within yourselves. And wherever you go, you will spread that happiness and that vibration within you. So that is what Brahmacharya is. It's not in conflict with any of the religions of the world. Yoga, Raj Yoga, we, Sanatan Dharma, does not ever believe in converting anybody. They basically say, look, the sun is the sun, it shines, everybody can see it. So you have to experience the bliss, and you have to be pulled yourself towards this beautiful depth. Sages and saints, these secrets that they have found, it is really Gyan and Vigyan. Gyan is knowledge, and Vigyan is practical application of that knowledge. So Sanatan Dharam doesn't just believe in Gyan. It also says, now that you know what to do, now go do it. We want you to experience that joy. And that's what that Vigyan is all about. It is the most important science. So that's why it becomes a science. Raj Yoga is a science. You can control your mind, you can control your emotions, you can make a better individual out of yourself. So this is also self-development in a way. You know, in addition to just being spiritual, you'll be holistically happy in everything that you do. So it guides one along the path of life to the goal of self-realization. And that's what we believe is the human potential, to become Brahman, to connect with God. It's like a river merging into the ocean and becoming the ocean. So that is sutra number one that we have studied. And I will bring to you sutra number two tomorrow. Om Tat Sat.